So, I will pop up here. There, you can see me now. I'm in this red colored world. Red is not important. It just looks good. The color can be yellow, green, blue, pink, whatever you wish. I will stay with red. The thing is, I belong to this red world. Note, I'm not enclosed by it. I am it. Bubble, horizon, shell, identity, filter, permanent sunglasses, whatever you may wish to call it. The red world is me. Coming out of it doesn't make sense. That's like asking the color red to come out of the color red. Culture, history, lifestyle, genetics, my social background, my economic background, my upbringing, my earliest memory. What colored shirt did my father wear when he played ball with me for the first time? What was the color of the ball? Do I come from a warm climate or cold weather? Were my ancestors fish-eating people or meat-eating? Did my people ever experience famine? Are we city people or did we live in the mountains? Me, I, this red world represents my entire essence. Similarly, you live in the blue world. When I talk to you, I use the word yellow. You imagine a cold yellow. My yellow is tinged with red. I will never be able to visualize your blue-tinged yellow precisely the way you see it. In the same way, you will never be able to see my yellow tinged with red. The red world is my language. Language here is not meant in the limited sense of the tongue or the dialect I speak, though that plays an essential role in any discussion of language. Mama in Spanish, Mom in English, Ma in Hindi, and Oka-san in Japanese all conjure images and associations that are rich and varied. Language here is meant as an essence of being, a system within which I exist. I do not understand your language. They spoke a different language. These and more such examples of pieces of everyday conversation refer to language being a system of practice, belief, and understanding, a form of life. To emphasize this point, Wittgenstein wrote, "The limits of my language are the limits of my world." I feel a strangeness in my stomach. I learn to call it pain. I will not understand the concept pain until I learn the language that publicly identifies that particular kind of discomfort as pain. So, there can be no private language. Language is shared. It's public. My sensations cannot make sense unless I have publicly shared words, phrases, and sentences to define them even for myself. Greed, ambition, aspiration, love, friendship, enmity are all aspects of a public language. I define myself through the dexterous use of this public language. I am master of a technique when I learn a language. Wittgenstein further went on to define language and hence our being as a series of activities that take the form of a game, a language game. We don't speak language, we do language. To teach a child the concept of a ball, it's not enough to point at the ball. We play with the ball so that she understands that the round-shaped object that is red in color is bouncy. It rolls away and rolls back. It's associated with moments of lightheartedness and fun. I had a ball of a time. I had fun. It was a ball. It was easy, smooth, fun. The language game does not follow rules. Pointing the middle finger at a stranger may be an act of insult and will be understood as such. The same action towards a friend may result in laughter. An alien would meet it with incomprehension. We make the rules as we go along. If one initiates a high five and no reciprocal hand appears to consummate the gesture, the initiator is said to have been left hanging. In the 1991 film Terminator 2 Judgment Day, the boy John Connor leaves the Terminator hanging after teaching him the high five. This could be interpreted as an insult or a friendly joke. Language is context dependent. John Connor's joke is met by the Terminator with perplexity and mild irritation, because the Terminator is embedded in a different form of life than the boy, John Connor. If a lion could speak, Wittgenstein famously stated, we would not understand it. Language is done in the shared horizon of experience. Beyond that is silence.